100 hardline deputies were forced to meet in another building because they were denied access to Parliament. And as they met, riot police arrived and refused to leave. They told the angry deputies they were there for their protection. But many, like Andre Golovin, didn't believe them.
Could be arrested. Simply arrested.
Commandos were spotted near the White House, many of them armed with shotguns. They moved into the Peace Hotel opposite the barricaded Parliament. Reporters on the scene said many of the commandos had helmets fitted out for night vision goggles. Others went to a nearby Moscow municipal building, said to be a major staging area. The building superintendent said he had been ordered to make room for 12,000 men. The reinforcements arrived as the government set a Monday deadline for all those still in the building to leave or face unnamed consequences. Defense Minister Pavel Grachev also said those in the White House were plotting terrorist attacks against the government and warned of large-scale bloodshed. An estimated 100 members of parliament are still holed up in the big white building on the Moscow River, refusing to give in to President Boris Yeltsin's decree banning the legislature. CNN personnel still in the building estimate about 400 other people, volunteer defenders and hangers-on, are also refusing to leave. All day long, government loudspeakers blared out for those in the building to lay down arms and leave. The man organizing the defense of the White House, a former Soviet general, issued a statement threatening to shoot government troops if they tighten the cordon put in place Tuesday morning, totally sealing off the building. That threat and veiled criticism from the Clinton administration about violations of human rights by Yeltsin, White House irregulars were busy with reinforcing their barricades.
Yeltsin has rejected the idea of compromise with a parliament that he says no longer exists. But he may now be faced with the prospect of trying to organize elections with the leaders of the opposition and their armed guards still holed up defiantly behind these barricades.
Once again this afternoon, protesters supporting the rebel deputies were in the streets. Last night's scenario was playing itself out again.
Rain fell on Moscow. The temperature once again rose at the police cordon near the White House. After hours of taunts from the small crowd of opposition demonstrators, police used their shields to force them back. Several of the mainly middle-aged protesters were struck by police truncheons. Shortly afterwards, news came through that one of the policemen injured in last night's rioting had died in hospital.
And there were scuffles with demonstrators supporting the deputies.
It has refused to broadcast the statements of opposition.
Our deputies remain holed up inside the parliament building in Moscow. They vow not to give up despite a public deadline issued by the Yeltsin government. But senior U.S. administration officials say Mr. Yeltsin still hopes to resolve the standoff peacefully.
Crackdowns on anti-Yeltsin demonstrators.
Riot police armed with shields and batons clashed with protesters supporting lawmakers inside. Elite paratroopers have reinforced police surrounding the building and the government.
Anyone trespasses on the parliament's territory, they will be shot.
Set a Monday deadline for those inside to surrender. Authorities say all those who leave peacefully before the deadline will not be prosecuted. The standoff began 1 week ago when Mr. Yeltsin dissolved parliament and called early elections. Russian Foreign Minister Andrei Kozyrev today said the government will settle the crisis without using force.
And as police moved in to clear the protesters, the government is reported to have issued yet another deadline to the parliamentarians to turn in their arms and to evacuate the parliament building by next Monday or face the consequences. John Murray, CBC News, Moscow.
Security measures despite the weather. Supporters of Russia's besieged parliament.
The parliament supporters are doing nothing so drastic. Each evening,
hardliners trying to force their way to the barricaded parliament building.
A protester pushed him under a moving car.
White House. The occupation began more than a week ago when Mr. Yeltsin dissolved the parliament. Today, President Clinton reaffirmed his support for the way Mr. Yeltsin is handling the crisis. CNN's Wolf Blitzer explains why.
And they're not yet ready to back down. Boris Yeltsin has promised deputies that if they leave the White House peacefully before Monday's deadline, they will not be prosecuted.
Wednesday night, another demonstration. Police pushed protesters back into the Barrikadnaya metro station near the White House.
Hundreds of parliamentary supporters quickly intensified.
They gathered to challenge the security lines established by the president's troops. As these confrontations have grown to be more of a ritual, the police are abandoning their original restrained approach. Communists.
Second night in a row, riot police.
Is what Russia's political crisis has come to. Clashing again with police on the same street where an officer died.
one more carrot in the hopes that he can keep his promise to spare the stick. Jillian Finley, CBC News, Moscow. Police had orders to keep them away from the White House. The people were determined. Boris Yeltsin's siege of Parliament is undemocratic and illegal, they say. The war of nerves is starting to fray nerves. Tonight, frustrated police lashed out at Western cameramen. Despite the
government has set a Monday deadline for hardliners occupying the Russian Parliament building to give themselves up.
In their rage, they're also now risking getting beaten and bruised.
Yeltsin hasn't spelled out what those consequences might be, but he stated he will not use violence unless provoked. Yet heavily armed riot police have tightened their control around the so-called Russian.
But the remaining deputies number only about 100. 200 have defected to Yeltsin, and Yeltsin's men are taking a new line on the crisis. The deputies are misguided.
But it is proving effective. Inside Parliament, the ever-dwindling number of deputies kept up their candlelight Congress, vowing again to defy any ultimatum from Yeltsin or his forces.
But reportedly, they are well-stocked with weapons and show no signs of retreating.
In this surreal setting, with virtually no electricity or heating, the besieged parliamentary deputies still carry on with their debates by candlelight. According to Western diplomatic sources, the body of a man was brought out of the parliament today, his death possibly caused by the intense cold in the building, now the temperatures have dropped below zero. Leading the resistance inside the White House is Alexander Rutskoy, now with a submachine gun strapped around his shoulder. He says if the armored personnel carriers do attack, they'll be destroyed. We won't fire the first shots, he promises, but if Yeltsin's men move in, we'll beat them. It'll be a fight to the finish.
Some of the rebels have rigged up a shortwave radio transmitter. They are broadcasting pleas for help from anyone in Russia who will listen. But no one is coming to the rescue.
Women holed up inside the White House, increasingly isolated and jittery, are putting a brave face on things, but the odds against them are overwhelming. Question now is not if, but when the standoff will end, and will that happen without bloodshed?
And at night Wednesday, Russian Interior Ministry troops were just as busy, moving on the perimeter of the cordon that has totally isolated the White House, that is already without telephones, heat, hot water, or electricity.
There was no immediate lessening of the tension outside. More military power was moved into position. These bulletproof armored personnel carriers are capable of smashing through barricades with squads of assault troops. Thousands of heavily armed troops, some of them elite paratroopers, remain on standby within a one-minute run to the parliament.
Vehicles are now stationed outside the Russian White House. This after a Yeltsin order yesterday to the lawmakers hold up inside the parliament to give up and leave or face serious consequences. Meantime, there's a reported offer of compromise by some of the hardliners. CBS News correspondent Cindy Kennard has more from Moscow.
Six armored vehicles rolled in just after dawn and took up positions around the building. The vehicles are in the same area where demonstrators have fought with police. A seventh armored vehicle is in front facing the bank of the Moscow River. The action comes a day after Yeltsin gave the rebel lawmakers a reprieve. Yeltsin has given them a new...
Early this morning, 11 armored personnel carriers moved into position around the Russian parliament. It's given the besieging security forces a more menacing look, and it's increased fears that there'll be a bloody end to this crisis, especially after the government gave their opponents a new ultimatum to surrender by Monday.
Interior Ministry beefed up its encirclement of the building with armored personnel carriers. And across the river from the White House, the Hotel Ukraine began evicting paying guests to make room for 1,000 additional troops being sent to enforce the cordon around the White House.
Half a dozen armored vehicles moved into positions outside, but there's been no sign of any confrontation between the troops and demonstrators gathered there. Wednesday, Russia
has reassured leaders in the West that he will not storm the building. But his men here drop ominous hints about violence just ahead, and no one knows which is the truth.